Welcome to Ask GMBN Tech. Of course, this is the weekly Q&A show. You ask the questions and we try and give you the right answers. Get your questions into the email address on the bottom of the screen there, or get involved in those comments. Don't forget to use the hashtag AskGMBNTech. Okay, SERVIUS asks, if my bike has a 130mm travel fork and 120mm of suspension on the rear, is it enough for some easy blue downhill trails, mostly cornering and some small jumps? I'm planning on visiting a resort in the summer and would like to hit the bike park, but I'm afraid I'm going to bottom out because I don't have a lot of travel. Yeah, absolutely fine. Even a hardtail will be fine. It'll be less comfortable, of course, but you don't have to worry about that sort of thing, especially on blues, greens, any trails like that, and even reds you're probably okay on, as long as you don't go too near some of the bigger features. Now, don't worry about your suspension bottoming out. That's a good sign that you're actually using all of your suspension. Now, generally, on an average ride, you should be bottoming your suspension out a couple of times, really. That means you're using the full suspension, it's set up correctly to your weight, and you're getting what the suspension should be doing. Now, if you're not, then perhaps you need to have a look at adjusting your suspension slightly. If you're unsure on how to adjust your fork or your shock, I'm going to link two videos below this. So if you look in the description underneath, they should hopefully guide you through the basics of what you need to understand there. But don't worry too much about the bike. I think the bike will be absolutely fine. So provided your bike is set up for you, it's going to be no problem. Now, something you could do just to increase your comfort and also make the bike feel like it has a bit more travel is perhaps consider the option of getting some slightly larger volume tyres. They're going to have more grip, it's going to make the bike feel more comfortable, more stable, and at the end of the day, it's going to be basically a nicer experience for you. So that's definitely a cheaper and probably a better option than changing a bike or any other things you might be looking at. Okay, now a question from Crank One Open. Why does my Nun drive side crank keep loosening? Is it because my lead foot is Nun drive side? Should I learn to bunny hop with drive side in lead? If I go over torque specs on the crank arm, the cranks will drag during rotation. All right, so if your crank is installed correctly and is torqued up correctly, it shouldn't loosen. That is assuming that the interface between the axle and the end of the crank is not being rounded, it's not damaged in any way, it's a good positive fit, and it's sat on there squarely. Now, the fact that you say that if you over torque it from what the recommended torque setting is, it sounds like it's tightening up. To me, it sounds like that's preloading the bearings too much, just squashing the bearings. If that's the case, then your bottom bracket might not be installed properly into your frame. It does sound, if you've got a screw-in bottom bracket, that you need one of those little spacers. They're 2.5mm spacers. Now, I don't know your details on your particular bike. It could be one on the drive side or one on the non-drive side, but I think you'll find that's probably the solution. You put one of those in, then put your cranks on. They should bottom out completely when you're tightening this thing up. And you should be able to tighten it up like insanely tight, really. Like, the torque on a crank is very tight, and you should be able to freely spin them. I would check that first. It does sound like that's your problem. It's nothing to do with being left foot forward, right foot forwards, any of that stuff. If your crank's not installed properly, that is a symptom of it. So good luck, I hope you haven't damaged it. All right, from Christopher Grimmer next. Hey Doddy, I removed the outer sleeve of my RockShox Monarch Plus shock to see the conditions of it, and some oil dripped. Is this normal? I've seen many of your videos showing how to remove the sleeve, to put in volume spacers and so on. I've never seen oil dripping or this being mentioned in a video. Thanks. Now, assuming yours is the type where you slide that sleeve off to expose the volume spacers, the red spacers, then no, it's absolutely fine. The oil that will be there is just purely lubricating oil in order for that sleeve to slide over them in the first place. So as long as it's a few drips, you've got nothing to worry about. If oil's like literally dripping out of there, non-stop, then it sounds like the damper on the inside might actually have a leak. And all that will be is like a leaky O-ring or something like that, and it might just need a service. The same applies if you're actually unscrewing the whole air can and there's some oil dripping out. That's just lubrication oil that goes on the shaft when you assemble the shock. And again, nothing to worry about. You can easily replace that. You can get some oil, you can get Fox float fluid. There's a whole number of other similar oils out there for that purpose. I wouldn't be too worried about it. It does sound to me it's just lubricating oil, not damper oil. Oh, this one's good. So from BenPat43. Ask GMBN Tech, do you ever think mountain bikes will adopt the floating disc brake? A lot of dirt bikes have them. Yeah, been there, done that. So on screen right now is the Mountain Cycle San Andreas. So this dates back, I think, to 1991. So this bike was so many firsts. It was one of the first full suspension bikes, one of the first monocoque aluminium full suspension bikes, or any bike, full stop. It was one of the first bikes to have an inverted fork, and it was an inverted single crown fork. And it was also one of the first bikes to have disc brakes on it. And they weren't just disc brakes, they were floating disc brakes, 230 millimeter rotors, massive, even bigger than what we have by today's standards. They were also hydraulic calipers and they were cable operated. So this bike was leagues ahead of its time. Now, the thing with floating discs, they're great, they allow for like heat expansion and stuff like that, but proper floating discs, they rattle, they're noisy, they're annoying. On a bicycle, you notice that sort of thing. On something with an engine, you're never gonna notice that. Now, this might sound like a bit of a trivial thing, but actually it does make a big difference. And of course, the manufacturing of these discs, look how heavy duty the disc rotors are, the ones on screen. They are huge and they do weigh a lot. Modern disc rotors don't need to be like that, but there are some floating discs out there. Now, Hope have experimented with floating discs and dual, like twin skin discs over the years to further dissipate heat. What they've settled on is a very similar thing to what SRAM brakes are doing now, and they have essentially an alloy spider which is riveted to a steel braking unit. So here's one of the Hope ones on screen, and here's one of the SRAM ones on screen. So you can see the kind of similarities in what they're looking for. And the idea is the aluminium spider dissipates the heat from that braking surface, and the rivets allow some sort of expansion and basically some movement of that disc rotor itself. But also bear in mind, compared to dirt bikes or motocross bikes, mountain bike discs don't get anywhere near as hot. So there's not quite the necessity to have full-time floating discs. But they've been experimented with, they are around, they are floating around, excuse the pun, but just not always necessary. Okay, now from Ryan Stevens. Doddy, I'm looking at a new enduro or trail bike. My budget can't get to a top spec carbon bike. Do you think it's better to get a top spec suspension bike in aluminium over a lower spec bike with a carbon frame? Thanks, really enjoying the show. Well, thanks for the props on that. Personally, I would pick the better spec'd aluminium bike. Now, carbon bikes look fantastic and they have lovely ride attributes, but there's also nothing wrong with aluminium. Just because maybe your friends have got carbon or you're seeing a lot of posh carbon bikes out there, don't feel lured to go for that. There's nothing wrong with alloy. I've got an alloy bike and I absolutely love it. Now, that said, if you want to go for a carbon frame, if that's what you want, and you want to ride that frame and upgrade it in time, then you need to consider what's on that bike. Now, when making a choice on bikes, let's say you've got a 4,000 budget on the bike. So you're looking at a higher spec alloy or a cheaper spec carbon bike. Now, you need to be careful because the lure here that the manufacturers are luring you in with is the fact that you've got a carbon frame. So in your eyes, you're thinking, wow, like it's got a carbon frame, it's gonna be lighter, stronger, all the rest of it. It's gonna look better, technically it's gonna last longer, all that sort of stuff. However, to make that cost the same as the alloy bike, which is substantially cheaper and easier to manufacture than the carbon offering, they have to save money in other places. Now, on a bike, if it's got cheap transmission, that doesn't matter. That's a consumable part of the bike. Don't be quick to upgrade it, just wear it out. Then get it recycled and upgrade it to a better one at the time. You can start saving from the minute you buy your bike. People often buy bikes and the first thing they do is chuck on a new cassette, chain, a better rear derailleur. Don't do that, there's no point. It's gonna wear out anyway, so just use it. What is important are the wheels, the shock, and the fork on the bike. Everything else is stuff that's easily upgradable in time. So even the wheels can be upgraded. However, a cheap, heavy set of wheels, A, they're gonna be weaker, B, the hubs are gonna wear out quicker, and C, they're gonna feel really lethargic, heavy, and the bike is not gonna have that nice ride quality that you would expect it to have given it's got a carbon frame. If you compare the same build, price for price, with the carbon one against the alloy equivalent, you'll find the alloy one's probably got much lighter, stronger, and better wheels. That's not the end of the world, because wheels, you can obviously replace them one by one, you don't have to do that in a pair, but rear shock and a suspension fork, they are two very expensive things to upgrade as independent units. Now be careful here, because the alloy frame may well have a better spec'd shock on it and a better spec'd fork, whereas the carbon frame, in order to keep that price down to give you that higher quality frame that you're looking for, it may well have a cheaper shock and fork. Now a lot of budget forks and shocks are absolutely fine, but just make sure that the ones that are on your particular choice are ones that you can upgrade, you can tune them, you can adjust them to what you want. Make sure it has the rebound, the compression damping that you want on there. Make sure if you want to be doing this sort of thing that you can put air volume spaces in there. The same goes for the fork. And with a suspension fork as well, make sure it's something that if you want to, you can upgrade the internals on the inside at a later date. Now, it's not something that everyone chooses to do, but if you're stuck with a base end fork, really there's nothing you can do with it except use it, sell it, buy another fork to go on there. And sometimes that can be £1,000 to stick on the front of a bike. So quite often you'll find that alloy bike will have a really good fork on it. So for that reason, I would pick the alloy in this case, but just take into account if you want to save a bit of cash on the rest of the componentry and get that really good frame, just make sure you've got a few fundamentals in there. Wheel size comparison from William Dunn. Now, I've noticed on many new bikes that come in 29 inch and 27.5 inch, they've got differences in the amount of suspension travel. For example, the Nukeproof Mega has 10 mil difference between the 27.5 and the 29er. Why are they doing this? That's quite a good question. William. Well, really, it does differ between brands because they don't always do this, but really what I can think is it offers the same characteristics of what they want the bike to be between the wheel sizes. Now, the Nukeproof Mega clearly is an enduro-focused bike. Its strength really is in rough, fast, and descending. Like, sure thing, it will climb up anything like a goat, but it's not comparable to lighter weight trail bikes. This bike is a beast. Now, on the 27.5 inch wheel, you've got slightly more travel on the frame. Now, you need that travel to tame the characteristics of those wheels, but also retain the agility of the bike. Now, it's the other way around with the bigger wheels. The bigger wheels on the 29er allow a little bit more rollover, a little bit more of a steamroller effect on bumps. If you continue the same wheel travel through, you've suddenly got a bike that feels like an absolute monster. So reducing the travel gives the same or very similar characteristics between the two. Now, the 29er, despite being such a huge bike, and I know because I've got one, it's actually pretty agile, like surprisingly so. You just wouldn't think that it would be for such a big bike. And that's done purely by keeping that travel down, keeping it feeling a bit more stout. Now, it's not always the case. Like Evil bikes, for example, the Reckoning, that's a 160 29er. That's got more travel than their 27.5 inch equivalent version, which has, I think, 151 millimeters of travel. It's an insane bike, and it's basically designed to sort of just smash through anything that you want. But that's not always what a bike manufacturer wants out of their bikes. If they're offering with twin wheel sizes, they often want the frame to be the shine out thing, and you pick the wheel sizes to suit how you want to ride that bike. Okay, so there's another weekly Q&A show in the bag. If you've got any questions or any comments or anything like that, get them involved in the comments below and we'll get back to you for next week. For a couple more useful videos, click down here for some classic workshop mistakes and click down here for some trailside hacks. As always, don't forget to subscribe to GMBN Tech. We love having you guys here. Share it around to everyone and give us a thumbs up.